Well, so much for being here today. It's a beautiful spring Saturday morning, and here you are at St. George's Church. I'm Lee Spruill. I'm the rector here, senior pastor, and I greet you on behalf of our entire leadership team, our staff, our lay leadership, our vestry, and all our volunteers today. This is a great honor for us to host this special event and conversation, and once more, really, really appreciate seeing this room as filled as it is. I'm just wondering if those of you who might be seated next to an empty seat might raise your hand if you see somebody coming in the door and standing, looking. We're pretty filled, but there are at least a dozen additional seats, and I wouldn't be surprised if a dozen additional people show up. So, well, that makes a lot of sense. Your teacher. So if you're situated next to one of those empty seats, why don't you scooch in and leave the empty seats on the aisles? Okay, I see that. Well, St. George's Church is feels incredibly blessed, lucky, to even partner in this weekend event featuring our special guests. I first want to give great thanks to the ministry and to the leadership of Siloam Family Health Clinic, on whose board I've been privileged to sit for, I guess, the last 6 years. Morgan Wills, the executive director of Siloam, is here, and lots of board members and other volunteers. And I just want to encourage you, I'm getting in a quick commercial. If you are unfamiliar with that organization, you ought to become familiar with it. It is a place of incredible ministry, blessing untold people every week. I'm also very thankful for Christ Church Cathedral, with whom we're also partnering in this event. My colleague and good friend, Timothy Kimbrough, approached me some months ago asking if we would like to join in this weekend's event, and I said, of course we would. We would love that. Timothy, unfortunately, has an out-of-town commitment and is not able to be with us this week, but I know that Joshua Kaler, one of his colleagues on the staff there, is present, and you'll be hearing from him at the end of the morning. Here's the breakdown of how we're going to spend our time. We're now beginning session one, and you're going to hear from Norman Wurzba. We're going to go until about 5 minutes to 10, and we'll have a break. Bathrooms are out in the hallway. They should be pretty obvious. They're on the left side of the hall as you're walking that way. We also have a reception area down the hallway if you're walking toward the church, where there'll be some refreshments at the break. We're going to take 20 minutes. We're going to come back in here at 10:15 and hear from Ellen Davis, also from Duke Divinity School. And then there will be a conversation that includes Wendell Berry, and we'll end around noon or at noon. Okay, not to be vague about that. The formal introductions will be in just a moment by another dear friend and fairly new friend, Keith Metter. Keith is the director for the Center of Biomedical Ethics and Society at Vanderbilt University. He's also a professor of psychiatry and health policy, fellow board member at Siloam, and member of Christ Church Cathedral. Again, thank you for coming. Let's offer up a word of thanks and prayer. Thank you for gathering us as your people, Lord God, this morning. Thank you for all that you're about to do. Bring your Holy Spirit into our listening and discernment, and bless your servants, Ellen, Norman, and Wendell. We are a part of a story that began a long time ago in your creation, and it's a story that's still going on through Christ, who is both Lord and lover of creation. Help us to find our place in that story and to play our roles well and faithfully and in mutual dependence with others. Father, we pray that you would help us in what we hear and consider this morning to return to an appreciation of our embodied natures as divinely created beings at once of the earth and of the heavens. May our time together recall to us that love and health and wholeness is not an abstraction, but bound to people and place and practices. and so enlarge our vision of what it is to be fruitful and to multiply. May the beauty of this spring day be a sign of the glorious reign of your Son, the resurrected Jesus Christ, in whom we pray. Amen. Amen. Keith?
Thank you, Lee. Raise hands for spots that people can still find seats. How are we doing in the back? Are we finding something for everyone? So raise your hand. There's some seats still over here. Have some seats over here in this corner if you're willing to weave your way through. I want to give you sort of an intro to all of our three speakers this morning, our three core persons. And many of you know some about each one of them. I just want to sort of get that out of the way to get the good, solid introduction so that those of you who are not as familiar with some of the work can know who we're having the privilege of hearing from this morning. And then we will be relatively on the schedule that Lee was just describing, but we're going to also, you know, this morning, where if you were with us last night, we had to stay on time really regularly. We're going to stay on time today, but we're doing it Wendell Berry style, okay? We're on farm time today, okay? So we're not going to worry a lot about, you know, every detail of time. We're going to enjoy the time and learn from one another in, I think, a very substantive way. I want to first start with tell you a little bit about the, we're going to work our way back to our first speaker of the morning. And first I want to mention that Professor Ellen Davis will be part of the round table later in the morning. And Ellen, many of you may know Ellen's work. I think a lot of you do, but Ellen is the, and I want to make sure I get this right, so because it's a fairly distinguished title that Ellen carries at Duke. Ellen Davis is an old friend and very dear to me, and she is the Amos Reagan Kearns Distinguished Professor of Bible and Practical Theology. So you can understand why I needed to read that to make sure I got that correct. But those of you who know Ellen's work will appreciate the depths of what she brings to bear in any conversation, in any context that she in which she speaks. I want to mention just briefly a couple of the particularly relevant recent publications of hers, specifically a recent book, Scripture, Culture, and Agriculture, an Agrarian Reading of the Bible, which came out in Cambridge University Press. I think it captures much of what we're trying to address in some ways this morning, and the eruditeness with which Ellen talks about these issues in this context is a gift to us all, and to have her here with us today is a really special privilege and she'll be correcting any of the errors that Norman makes. Right, Norman? So we're counting on a great time from a thoughtful and informative comments from Ellen, and it's a gift to us to have her here. She will be preaching tomorrow morning at Christ Church Cathedral. So tomorrow morning, if you worship there or if you sometimes visit there, and not to take away from St. George's, sorry, Lee, but but an invitation to Christ Church in the morning, that if you would like to hear Ellen preach, she's a phenomenal preacher, she will be there in the morning. Then along with Ellen, in our commenting and our sort of further discussion after Norman's presentation, will be Wendell Berry. I'm sure, confident everyone here knows of Wendell's work, his thoughtfulness, author of more than 50 books. I could go on and on about his many awards, including the Jefferson Lecture in 2012, a major significant honor in the humanities with national significance. But what I really want to share with you this morning about Wendell is a paragraph written by Norman, who will be our sort of keynoter this morning, in a book that I really commend to you. It's quite a sort of an assimilation of crucial works from Wendell, The Art of the Commonplace, The Agrarian Essays of Wendell Berry. And Norman edited and introduces this book. And I want, in describing Wendell for you and to you, I want to just give this framework which Norman offers to us as a description. Among contemporary writers, few have seen and described as clearly the causes and effects of our dis-ease as has Wendell Berry. In poetry, fiction, and essay, he has not only characterized the destructive effects of our general homelessness, but more important, has also promoted a cogent and viable alternative in the form of agrarian thought and practice. Agrarianism, rather than being a quaint throwback to an impossible pastoral Arcadia, is, in the hands of and mind of Berry, a necessary and practical corrective to the waywardness of modern industrial culture. Agrarianism, in other words, promises a path toward wholeness with the earth, with each other, and with God, a path founded upon an insight into our proper place within the wider universe. I think that's a nice, really concise encapsulation of the great gift that Wendell Berry is to all of us. And so as not to offend him, I want to acknowledge, I try to avoid idealizing him, okay? And I try to avoid the idolatry. Okay, so he's not perfect, all right? And Tanya could probably give us the true verification of that. But he's pretty distinctive, okay? And I think Norman captures very nicely there the fullness of what Wendell Berry brings to all of us, and we'll look forward to the time with him later this morning. At this point, I want to introduce our core presenter this morning, Dr. Norman Wersba. Norman is professor of theology and ecology at Duke University Divinity School. Is a longstanding friend and mentor. Right? I look to Norman's work for guidance and thoughtfulness on many different topics, and his most recent book on Food and Faith by Cambridge University Press was, I think, one of those sort of tour de force. It's one of those special offerings that I would commend to all of us to spend time in. And you're not going to just sit down and read it casually. It's a little too dense for that. But it's worth the time and the effort to spend on Food and Faith. And we're going to hear more from Norman about that this morning. But I also would commend to you to look at many other books that Norman has written, all of which I think are constructive for us, but particularly a little book of Norman's called Living the Sabbath. I just think it's a treasure. And I would commend it to any of us to sort of make it part of our own life, but also to share it with our neighbors as a way to challenge us about how to live in a very particular way in a challenging context and world that we live in. So Norman offers us much to consider in his scholarship and in his work. And I consider it a true privilege that we have him to sort of give us a framing for our conversation this morning in follow-up to some of what we discussed last night about what makes a healthy community. Norman is going to speak on Food and Faith, A Matter of Health and Wholeness. And I really know of no one else that could do it comparably or with the same exceptional capacity that Norman has. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Norman Wersba.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? It's working? Excellent. No, we cannot hear. Can you hear now? Better? You in the back, can you hear? Good. So Keith says we're on farm time, and it's harvest, and so we have to get busy, and it's going to take a little while. But I want to say some more general things first about our food sector, and then try to see how some theological ways of thinking about food and eating might help us, especially as we're trying to think about building healthy communities and healthy lands. So that's sort of the broad trajectory for this morning. I want to start with an observation from the Shakers, who had as their practice a lengthy period of silence before we eat. And I think this is really important. Right? The question would be, why take so much time to stop before you eat? And I think one of the reasons would be that, I don't know about you, but when I sit down to eat, my head is just packed full of all the things going on in my world. And so it doesn't take very long for us to discover that when we're eating, we're not paying any attention to what we're doing. And I think it's not just that we're not paying attention to what we're doing, we're not paying attention to the significance of what's happening when we're eating. I am a philosopher too, and so I like to think about really fundamental things like, what are the root meanings that are operative within our behaviors, within our actions? And some of the things that are most basic to us, like eating, we don't attend to. And so I want us to slow down a little bit and ask, what has happened when we take in food? Because eating, whether we acknowledge it or not, is one of those great acts of intimacy in which we enact our relationship to the whole world. Because for any of us to eat, we have to be involved in the lives of microorganisms in soil, in worms, in the life of plants, processes of photosynthesis, weather systems, the lives of butterflies and bees, right? We all, I think, know what happens if we don't have bees. We starve. So we ought to be thinking about the bees. We have to be thinking about the farm workers and the farm communities that make possible foods production. What's their condition? Are they healthy? Are they vibrant? We have to think about land use practices. How is the land being cultivated? How is our water being used? We have to think about the justice or the injustice of the economies that bring food to us. We have to think about the people who harvest the food, who ship and process our food. We have to think about the people who cook and serve the food. Right? There's so much to think about every time you take a bite. And so for me, the wonder is if we ever get to eat at all. Because how long would we have to observe silence so that we could begin to take in the world that is behind every bite? Mindful eating, as I think many of you know, has become difficult because we are called a fast food nation. Many of us, I think, have the experience of eating very quickly. And it's not just because we have brothers who will threaten to take the food if you don't eat it quickly, but we eat on the run. We eat on the go. We eat in our cars. We eat at a desk while we're working. And we eat alone much of the time. And this way of eating, I think, reflects a lot about cultural sensibilities that we might have to spend some time talking about in a little bit. But that's not the crucial focus I want to have today. I want us to think about how in our eating today we have become so unmindful of what we're doing because we have so little practical, experiential knowledge of what it takes to grow food. How many of you have gardens? Well, that's really encouraging. How many of you are farmers? Excellent. But you notice that there were very few hands that went up on the last question. And if I were to ask, how many of you have parents who were farmers? How many hands go up? Okay, now keep them up. How many of you have grandparents? Great-grandparents, right? Every hand goes up. Now, do you see what's happened? Okay, do you realize that we are utterly unique in the history of humanity because so few people now have any intimate practical knowledge of land, of the processes that are required, the practices that are required, the knowledge that's required, the affection that is required to grow food. And in this great cloud of ignorance, we are so easily prone to commit in our purchasing patterns to practices that are greatly destructive of our land, of our farming communities. And this is very significant. Never before have there been in human history so few people who have any insight about what's necessary to grow food. I need for you to think about that. The result also of us not being involved in much of our own food production is that we know so little about the fragility of life, the vulnerability of life, the mystery of life, the tragedy, the serendipity, the hope that comes out of the land, that comes out of our engagement with other living things. We don't have very much the patience that is required to grow food. To live in a consumer food culture like most of us now do means that we can walk into a grocery store and there will be a lot of food there. And it'll be very attractive. It'll be packaged beautifully, and it'll be fairly cheap. And we have it year-round. So where is the need for us to be patient? Where is the need for us to be attentive? Where is the need for us to develop relationships of care so that this food will be with us for a very long time? We also don't appreciate the temptation to be violent. If you grow food, you know, I think, what I'm talking about. So I'll start with a story. When my wife and I bought our first home, we had two small girls. And I hadn't had a whole lot of gardening experience. I grew up farming, but I didn't do a lot of gardening. I helped my mom pick potato beetles, but that's about it. So we were going to grow strawberries. I figured, you know, this is something my girls will really love, and I sure love strawberries. So we made a garden bed, we put in the strawberry plants, and it was just wonderful to watch these plants grow to maturity. And sure enough, soon you start to get those green strawberries, and they start to turn pink, and then they're starting to turn red. And we're getting excited because we know it's close to the time when we can pick the strawberries. So I say, next day, we're going to go get them. So I go out there the next day, and guess what's happened? The slugs and the ants have come. Because God creates a smart world, right? The slugs and the ants, they also know when the strawberries are ripe. And so they came to enjoy those strawberries. And I was furious because those were my strawberries. They were for my girls. So I was furious, and so like any right-thinking American, I'm actually Canadian, I went to Walmart to buy a pest management solution. And you know what these solutions look like? They're in those green bottles. And in very unmanlike fashion, I read the directions. And the directions said basically this, right? Do not let children or pets near the sprayed area for 3 days. And burn any clothing that comes in direct contact with this solution. So I read this and I said, okay, now I'm going to put this on my strawberry plants and then we're going to eat them. Okay, now I thought, this is crazy, right? But this is the way we do agriculture, right? I grew up where we used not these green bottles, we had 500-gallon tanks with sprayers and we went out on our fields and we regularly sprayed our fields so we would have a pest management solution. And of course, this is a great act of violence because we have come to believe that whenever we have a problem, the way to deal with it is to poison, bulldoze, burn, or explode our way through it. And so it's no accident then that we have agricultural systems now which rely on unbelievable amounts of poison. Right? So to promote food fertility, we kill. There's a kind of strangeness in the logic, but it works for at least the short term. And we don't see the kinds of problems this creates. But it's not just the pest management solution of what are we going to do with those slugs. My mom actually gave me a good idea of what to do with them. You get a lid and you put beer in it. And then the slug crawls into the beer and it's death by drowning and drunkenness. Which, if you're a slug, is a good way to go. So it's actually an act of charity, I think, to help the slug on its way, and you get to eat the strawberries. It's a good deal. But you have to kill the slug. Or more recently, my problem is that I live in an area where there are a lot of deer. And some of our great frustration is that I can spend a lot of time working on a garden and have it all eaten by the deer. I want to kill the deer. I want to kill the rabbits that just ate my jalapeno peppers. Right? We're in this battle. And how do we learn to live in a context where other creatures want to eat the same things you do? Right? I think we need to attend to this little curiosity in our grocery stores. When I do this, I go into the fruit section and I look for the fruit, and I look for the fruit that has no blemishes. Well, you know how fruit gets to have no blemishes, right? You have to spray it. But of course, that means that no other creature wanted to eat it, but we do. Right? So we're feeding ourselves this poison. It's a strange world. And I think a lot of the strangeness of that world and our temptation to be impatient, to become violent and ruthless, is exacerbated by our consumer condition. If we were in the context of growing food, we'd have to deal with these things much more personally, much more up close. We'd have to see that we need levels of skill that many of us simply don't have. Right? I'm trying to garden, but I'm not very smart. Because I realize that to grow food and grow it well, and in quantities that are of sufficient size, requires an intelligence that I don't have. I need more help. Gardening is also, I think, important because it teaches us something about frustration. We have been taught to believe that food should be easy. And that's a lie. Food isn't easy. And a writer that I like quite a lot, Robert Pogue Harrison, says that one of the reasons human beings have turned away from gardens is because gardens confront us with our own impotence. They also remind us of our own death, but they certainly remind us of our own impotence, and we don't want to have to deal with that. And so we have become the purchasers of food. We sew up with our cash and our credit card, and we buy the stuff we want, make the swipe, and we walk away to enjoy. Do you understand how, for many people throughout the world's history, this is a fantasy world? This is a world that is unimaginable to people throughout history. That you could simply show up with a card, swipe, and have food. Wendell refers to this as the great modern superstition that money produces food. Right? We don't like to think that we're superstitious, but we are. It's a way of approaching food, consuming food, which assumes, of course, a great cloud of ignorance because we do not know where this food comes from. Wendell's also talked to this as, about this as the economy of the one-night stand. Okay, we meet, we have our fun, mostly in the dark, we don't ask questions, we pay our money, and then we leave. Right? We don't want to know too much of what's going on, but We have to ask the question, under what conditions was the food that we're eating produced? Do we know if the ways of production that went into this food, whether or not these ways of production can be sustained for very long? We don't know if the food that we're about to eat should be celebrated because it honored the land, it honored the animals, it honored God as the provider of these gifts of food, or whether or not we should be lamenting, whether we should be crying. I teach a class on food and eating and the life of faith, and a student said once, you know, maybe our saying grace needs to start with confession. Right? Maybe that's the first thing we need to start, is by saying, I'm sorry. But how would we know that? Because to be in an anonymous economy means you're not going to know that. If the food that you're eating comes hundreds or perhaps even thousands of miles away. We know from a lot of recent writing about industrial modes of food production that behind the processing and the slick packaging of so much that's in our stores, there are multiple stories of abuse, of degradation, exploitation, shame, right? And we could spend a lot of time talking about that, and that's not what we're going to do, but are we aware of how we depend upon poison in our water, soil that's being eroded, animals and farm workers that are being abused regularly as a matter of agricultural policy? This is our best thinking and practice about food production. And so we have very fundamental questions to think about. How are we going to be healthy in a context of a poisoned world? Right? How is that going to be possible? And then also, how are we going to be whole in the context of an economy that pits people against each other, that depends on the practice of rape? How are we going to talk about wholeness, right? These are important questions for us today. But can we envision something like this when we know that for us to have those really beautiful, big strawberries, that there are farm workers who are living in near slave-like conditions? And we want to talk about the wholeness of a society? Right? We may be fooling ourselves. Now, obviously, I think that religious faith has some valuable things to say about all of this. And I think one way to start is by seeing how what one thing religious faith can do for us is help us ask some really fundamental questions. And I want to start with one that's very, very important. And that's the question, what is food? Right? What is food? How do we name and narrate this reality? And I want to tell you that I think naming the food is so very, very important, because since Aristotle, at least, we have known that the name of things is crucial, because how you name things will determine how you're going to relate to them. And I'll start with an example. Imagine that I have brought into this room here a plant. And I tell you, okay, now this plant, it's a flower. Now think what's going through your mind right now. What are you thinking when you hear the word flower? It's pretty, right? Your response to a flower is to want to behold it. Maybe to get close and examine its petal structure, or get close enough to smell its fragrance, or get stung by a bee. Okay, that's what you associate with that term flower. But now I tell you, oh, wait a minute, I made a mistake. It's not a flower, it's a weed. Okay, now what's going on in your head? Yeah, you want to eradicate it. Because in the words of Monsanto, weeds steal the sunshine. So, when you have a weed, you have to get rid of it. Gets in the way of your bottom line. Even if it happens to be pretty. Right? So a friend of mine, Cal DeWitt, he's a wetlands ecologist in Wisconsin. He tells a wonderful story about how he moved into his town in Wisconsin, and he was very much opposed to putting poisons on his lawn. Because he says, it's an illusion. Why did we ever think that a lawn should resemble a carpet like you have in your house? doesn't make any sense. So he said, I'm not going to spray. But he realized that he was going to make a lot of his neighbors very unhappy. So he was figuring, how am I going to convince these people that they shouldn't spray their lawns without just being a little dictator going around pointing the big finger? So he said, well, I'm just going to let my lawn grow. And I'm going to let all the species of grass and flowers and weeds appear. And he started to take pictures of these and make postcards out of them. And he'd send the postcards to his neighbors and he'd invite them over for tea. This is wonderful. And they brought the postcards with them and they said, these flowers are so beautiful. Where are they from? He said, they're on my lawn. And they said, no. He says, yeah, I'll show you. And they said, now what this tea is so marvelous. What kind of tea is it? And they said, it's from my dandelions. It's on my lawn. And they said, well, can we make it? He said, oh, no, you mustn't, because you've got so much poison, you'd actually kill yourself. But as a result of this little campaign, he got his neighbors to say, this is crazy that we're spraying all of our lawns with all these poisons because there are beautiful flowers that grow, not all year round. But the transformation between weed and flower was so crucial because it shifted the whole mentality of the people there. But then there's another naming that's possible. Right? I hold this plant and I say, no, now it's a vegetable. It's a tomato plant. And if you wait a while, if you take care of it, you're going to get tomatoes. So now your response is not to eradicate it, not just to behold it, but to take care of this plant so that you can enjoy it. Right? Do you see the naming of this plant is so crucial? Because if you call it a flower, if you call it a weed, or if you call it a vegetable, you're going to have vastly different responses to that reality. Now think about the naming of our food that happens in our culture today. And the preferred term is commodity. Food is a commodity. Now what goes on in your head when you describe food as a commodity? Well, obviously, what you're doing is you're describing a whole logic that we call consumerism. It's a logic that assumes that the world is one big store, one big warehouse, and all we got to do is go pick out the commodities, right? We mine them. In fact, we've gotten so used to this whole logic of naming that we refer to our world as basically a stockpile of natural resources. I think it's a reprehensible term to talk about the world as a stockpile of natural resources. The place is a world of gift. It's the place where the sources of God's love become mediated to us. So why should we refer to it in this consumerist commodification form of language? But when we do have food primarily as a commodity, what's going to be most important in our minds? Well, we're going to think about the cost of the food. Is it cheap? We're going to worry about the convenience of the food. How easy is it for us to get it and to make it ready for us to eat? We're going to want to make sure that our food is available in copious quantities. And we're going to worry a lot about the style of the food. Right? Why should we think that the cheapness, the amount, the convenience of the food should be what's most important? It's not to say pricing isn't important. Of course it is. But our desire to have food very, very cheaply, cheaper than it's probably ever been in human history. Do we understand that behind that cheap price, or supposedly cheap price, there are tremendous costs to people, to land, to animals, to plants, to water systems that are not being factored in? And that we're making life extremely difficult for those people who do grow food, who are being squeezed to the margins, where they can't make a living if they didn't receive a subsidy check from a government. Right? These are realities that I think we need to have seriously in mind. So what might a theological naming of food look like? A good place to start, I think, is in the opening books of the Bible, in Genesis, or opening chapters, rather, Genesis 1 and 2. And I know that for many of you, these stories are going to be fairly familiar. So I'm just going to emphasize some of the elements. The first one, as you know, is the creation of the world in 7 days. And we know that this is a story in which the days are punctuated by God often making an observation about the world. And we're told that this is a beautiful world, that God finds it to be a very good world. And we find in this account a description by God saying that God's desire is for creatures to multiply and to be fruitful. And I want us to pause at that. Because to say that God wants the world to multiply and be fruitful is a statement about God's desire that creatures achieve the fullness of their being. Okay, think about this. God's desire from the beginning is that creatures achieve the fullness of their being. That means God wants all creatures to achieve all their potential, because in realizing their potential, they make possible, they make fulfilled, they maximize the divine love that brings them into being in the first place. Right? Think about that. God creates a world of creatures so that they can achieve the fullness of the love that is at work in their very being to be the things that they are. God delights from the beginning in the vigor and the variety and the vitality of life. It's sort of like when you taste a new food for the first time and you say, I had no idea this flavor was possible. Do you have an appreciation for the kind of excitement that must be operating in God's own life to see this world come into being and to see the love that is being fulfilled in the very materiality of the various bodies that can be alive and fecund and fertile and fruitful? Right? It's astounding. God never created out of an act of boredom. God does not create out of necessity. At least this is what theologians who spend a lot of time asking the question, why does God make a world at all? And their answers have been that it's not because God has to make anything. God creates as the one who loves material bodies and finds in those bodies a perpetual invitation to joy, to thanksgiving. This means that if anything exists at all, it's because God desires it to exist, and that God wants it to be the unique thing that it is. And so I want to read to you some lines from an Episcopal priest and chef, Robert Farrar Capon. If you don't know his book, The Supper of the Lamb, you might want to get a hold of it. He says this: God made the world out of joy. He didn't need it. He just thought it was a good thing. But if you confine his activity in creation to the beginning only, you lose most of the joy in the subsequent shuffle of history. Sure, it was good back then, you say, but since then we've been eating leftovers. How much better a world it becomes when you see him creating at all times and at every time, which is, of course, the way Scripture talks about creation. When you see that the preserving of the old in being is just as much creation as the beginning of the new out of nothing. Each thing at every moment becomes the delight of his hand and the apple of his eye. And so Capon would say that, like the Shakers who may begin by silence to attend to what's happening, Capon says at the end of the meal, you should offer a benediction, something like this, a toast to a radically, perpetually unnecessary world, to the restoration of astonishment to the heart and mystery to the mind, to wine because it is a gift we never expected, to mushrooms and artichoke, for they are incredible legacies, to improbable acids and high alcohols, since we would hardly have thought of them ourselves. To all being because it is superfluous. To the hairs on Harry's ear, and to the 768th cell from the upper attachment of the right gluteus maximus in the last girl in the chorus line. Proceed! Dear hearts, cheers, men and brethren, we are free. Nothing is needful. Everything is for joy. Let the bookkeepers struggle with their balance sheets. God is eccentric. He has loves, not reasons. Salut. I think this is really important to understand, because so many of us, when we think about God's creation of the world, we're basically deists. We believe that God made the world a long time ago and exited the premises. And what we fail to appreciate is God's constant love and joy in a world that is beautifully and wonderfully and mysteriously made. And I think this point is also stated with real clarity, though often overlooked, when we turn to day 7 in this creation story. For a variety of reasons, we've come to believe that creation is finished on day 6. I mean, it says that, right? That God finished all that God had made. But in the text, it's a little bit curious, because there seems to be a second finishing that is happening on day 7. And rabbis pondering about this came to a very important insight, I think. The rabbi said that it's true that God did finish making the material world on day 6. But what God had not yet finished was the purpose for everything. Right? It's one thing to make a good and beautiful world, but the question is why? Why do that? And the rabbi said the answer is to be found in God's own Shabbat. God rests on the seventh day to enjoy this world. And so God rests. And I want to pause for a minute to think about resting, because I know that for many people, resting means simply stopping from your activity. And the stopping is very important, for sure. Because we need to stop to reflect on what we're doing. But we think that the opposite of rest is somehow work or activity. And therefore, rest means something like checking out. So on my book, Living the Sabbath, there's a hammock. And I hate the cover. Not because I don't like hammocks, but because I said I think that communicates precisely what my book is not about. Because my book is not about escaping from the world. Because you see, God's resting in the presence of the world is actually God's deep immersion into it through the experience of joy. Because to have joy and delight means you have to have some deep sympathy and understanding for what brings you that delight and that joy. And so the opposite of rest is not some kind of activity. The opposite of rest is restlessness. And think about our culture and the forms of restlessness it creates in us. Restlessness means that what we have is not good enough. Restlessness is where we are is not good enough. Restlessness is the people we are with are not good enough. And why should we think that the grass is always greener somewhere else? Well, the answer is because they're watering it. Okay, we neglect, we despise, we forget, we ignore our places because we think somewhere else is better, because we have this built restlessness into us. And so I think it's entirely appropriate to say that ours is an anti-Sabbath economy. It's an anti-Sabbath culture, which prevents us from experiencing the joy and the delight that is possible if we were to attend to our world, to learn to care for it, to learn to love it in ways that perhaps we can understand by approaching God as the one who first makes and cares for the world. So I think this experience of God's own Shabbat is a clue to us about what it is we are supposed to be doing in our world with respect to the created bodies that surround us, that we have to consume, Right? And this is something we mustn't forget. The world exists. Life exists because we assume the flesh of the world. And this is a flesh that God loves entirely, that God delights in entirely. So if we attend to this creation story, and there's so much more that we could do, but that's enough for now, I think we will see that there's a very important conclusion we can draw about food's meaning and significance. And that is, as opposed to the view that food is a commodity, a biblical way of thinking about food would say that food is God's love and delight made delectable. Right? Food is not a commodity. Food is God's love and delight made delectable. Shouldn't it astound us that we live in a world that can taste so good? To understand that our food is God's love and delight made delectable is going to require some pretty major shifts in the way we think about ourselves and the way we think about our relationship to the world. And I think it starts with the realization that the world is a gift. Right? The language of commodity obscures this for us. But again, I think the experience of gardening can be important in helping us to appreciate something about how the world is a gift and make us come to terms with the fact how we tend to resist a reception of the world that way. How many of us much prefer to think that what we need to live, we achieve through our own effort? I earned my life. I earned my food. I worked for it. And this is not advice to being lazy. But I think it's tempting to want to say that we don't have to receive, because to learn to receive requires a kind of humility that a lot of us aren't prone to. And so we need more than ever the practices, I think, that will help us live into a reception of the world as a gift. And so I want to turn now briefly again to another story which begins in Genesis 2. This is also, I think, a story that a number of you know about. It's the story of the Garden of Eden. We often rush to chapter 3 because then we get the great story about sinfulness that happens there. But I want us to pause for a minute in the second chapter, because the picture of the world and of God that it gives us is simply astounding. In this story, we have a depiction of God as a gardener. So you'd walk into the scene, what you would find is God on God's knees, hands in the soil, holding it so close as to breathe into it the breath of life. Because that's what you are. You are soil animated by God's breath. This is an astounding picture, because compared to other ancient Near Eastern depictions of God and the creation of the world, which often presuppose violence, bloodshed, here you have a gardening God who again is on intimate terms with the material bodies of our world. This is a God who loves soil. Karl Čapek, the Czechoslovakian writer, said that if he'd have showed up at the Garden of Eden, the first thing he would have said is, "My God, what compost!" Because as a gardener, Čapek knows that what God loves is compost. Right? God loves soil. Do you appreciate that? God loves you and me, but God loves soil first, because without soil, there is no you or me. I remember one of our daughters, she was working in a garden. She's a much better gardener than I am. And she came home one day and I knew something clicked in her mind, because she said, "Dad, today we were working on compost piles and they're better than chocolate cake." Right? Now that's fabulous. Okay? This is astounding, the picture. Now let me ask you, how many of you have heard a sermon of God the Gardener? Okay, one hand. This is incredible, because in the Bible you will find God described frequently as a farmer and as a gardener. Why are there no sermons about this? This is a foundational story. This is the older of the creation stories. You'd think, okay, first impressions matter. We're being told something about God's character, God's life, and yet nobody talks about it. It's impoverishing our imaginations to have lost this understanding. And you can read Alan's book, Scripture, Culture, and Agriculture. It's a foundational book. It's an indispensable book because she recovers beautifully these images for us that are so important for the life of faith. What kinds of communities do we want to be? What kinds of economies do we want to see? How do we want to talk about work in our society? If you don't understand any of these gardening, agrarian images in the Bible, you're going to have a rather idealized, abstract notion of these things. But God's love is for the soil. And out of the soil come you and me. Out of the soil come the plants. Out of the soil come the birds and the animals. This is why God loves them so much. And then God does something really astounding. God takes this first Adam, who comes from Adama, and says, go into the garden and take care of it. And I know sometimes people will look at a verse like this and they'll say, well, see, this is a sign of the punishment of human beings for their disobedience, so they have to go work in a garden. Okay, that's what I would have thought as a kid going to pick potato beetles from 2 acres of potatoes. Okay, that's a lot of beetles. And it's hot and it's no fun. But this story is happening before there's any talk about punishment, of how labor is in some way a reflection of misdeed. I think it's much more appropriate to see this passage as saying that God is inviting us to enter into the life of gardening work because that is the work that God always does. And that by entering into the care of plants and animals and each other so that we can enjoy the fruit of the earth, that we learn something profound about who we are as creatures. That we learn something about our life with others. That we learn it's not easy. That we learn it isn't all happiness and joy. That we learn something about God's own patience and something about our own impatience. Gardening activities, gardening work are indispensable practices because they are invitations to human humility, propriety, and gratitude. The astounding thing about gardens is that they are places of surprise. They surprise us with things we don't want to know about ourselves, right? How lazy we are. Okay? It's hot in North Carolina in July and August, and I don't want to be outside weeding. And that's why I'm lazy. But if I don't do it, what's going to happen to the garden? Imagine if God said about us, they're just so stupid. I should just give up on them. Be much easier not to pay attention. But the astounding thing is that God doesn't ever do that. Because if God were to say, I've given up on the garden, we'd all die. As Psalm 104 says, if God ever turns God's face away, withholds the divine breath that animates the soil, that make all the creatures of this earth possible, it all fall to the ground and die. So God is the prototypical gardener who leads us into a life of care. Every one of us eats. That means each one of us is joined intimately through our bodies with the lives of all the creatures of the earth. We are dependent on each other. We have to draw our life from a bewildering array of relationships that join us to earthworms and butterflies and chickens and co-gardeners. The question is, how do we learn to be faithful in that context? We've learned from Wendell that to be healthy is to be whole. That health is not reducible to how we individually feel, nor can it simply be something like the absence of disease. In The Unsettling of America, he wrote that a healthy body, that in a healthy body, All the convergences and dependences of creation are implied. And that's why fragmentation, isolation, loneliness, neglect, boredom must be overcome. To be healed, Wendell says, we must come with all the other creatures to the feast of creation. Now, with the rest of our time, I'd like to see how we can find another passage in Scripture that might give us a clue about what that means. What's involved for us to live responsibly with each other, faithfully with each other? And I want to turn to the 6th chapter of the Gospel of John. It's a chapter that begins with a great story. About 5,000 people have assembled because Jesus is doing some pretty remarkable things. They've assembled on a grassy hillside, and Jesus notes that they're hungry. He wants to feed them. The disciples say, well, we can send them away to town and go buy some food. But Jesus doesn't attend to them that way. He finds that there is a boy in the crowd who has brought some fish and some bread, and in the act of blessing it, distributes the food to roughly 5,000 people, and they have enough to eat. And there's a bunch left over. It's an amazing story. It's an amazing miracle. And not surprisingly, the people want to make him king. Who wouldn't? When you're a world that lives on fairly intimate terms with hunger, to have met somebody who can produce food on demand, of course you want to make this person king. They want Jesus to be their grocery store manager. Because Jesus will provide food on demand. Right? Think about how many times that phrase appears in our culture today. On demand. But Jesus isn't interested in this. He wants something much more profound to happen. He wants these people to be transformed so that they will be a source of nurture and friendship to each other. He doesn't want them to be passive, ignorant, helpless consumers. He wants them to learn to become friends with each other. So he flees from the crowd, but they catch up with him. And he says to them something astonishing. He says, I'm the bread of life. He's the bread of life that comes from heaven and is a gift given for the life of the world, says the gospel. Now we have to think about what kind of bread is this. He says, it's my own flesh. He's offering himself in the action of love so that the bodies, all right, the bodies of others can be touched and fed and nurtured and healed and exercised and reconciled. Jesus is very concerned that the bodies of this world are not being taken care of. So when you read the Gospels, see how much Jesus is present to bodies, is attentive to bodies, and then ask yourself, where's Jesus' concern that souls get to heaven? You won't find that very much. Because Jesus is about bodies. And we know that Jesus cares about the happiness of these bodies, the health of these bodies. He's not interested in plucking bodies out of the world. Jesus is part of a theological tradition that understands the material world to be loved and delighted in by God. He understands that God wants creatures to flourish, to be fruitful, and to multiply. And this is why Jesus practices so much hospitality in the Gospels. John of Damascus, one of the early church writers, said that one way to understand God's work of creation is to say that it is one lavish act of hospitality. Because what hospitality is it is making room for what is not God to be and to flourish. So God makes room within the life of God so that all these creatures, this bewildering array of creatures, can come into being. And then God nurtures all of these creatures, giving them the food and the nurture that they need so that they can become themselves, right? This is the nature of love. This is why the love Jesus practices is not coercive. It's hospitable. It seeks the well-being of others. And he wants to teach us how we can participate in this kind of hospitable love. This is not love in abstract. This is not the kind of love that we hear from politicians where they say, I love everybody. How do you love everybody when you don't even know them? Right? This is particularizing love. And so in the context of our conversation today, we should ask, what kind of love do we need to take care of someone who comes to Siloam Health, who doesn't speak our language, who's a refugee, who's come from a camp? What kind of love is required there? What kind of love is required for a field so that it will be fertile for long? What kind of love is required for all of the migrant workers in this country who do the work that we all despise? Right? Every love that we need is going to be different. It's going to need skill. It's going to need training. It's going to need sympathy. It's going to be requiring affection from us and sensitivities that many of us probably don't have. So this is the first thing to see about Jesus. He cares about the well-being of these people who have come around. He wants them to be happy, right? Remember in John's gospel, the first miracle is Jesus turning water into wine. I love that story. Because, I mean, there's a lot you can say about the story, but in part, the story is to say that we shouldn't just have water in life. We should have wine. Salut! Okay? Second part of this story I think that's important is that we need to see how difficult it is for us to live this life of care that Jesus talks about. And so Jesus gives us this very graphic image where he says that you need to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And the Greek word here is tregain, which means it's not just nibble. You need to chomp and chew on my flesh. And the Jews who are there, of course, are rightly repulsed, and we should probably be repulsed by the image too. But the point, says John, is that in order for us to live, we need to have Jesus inside of us. Okay, this is what it means to say that Jesus is the bread of life. Unlike the bread that we normally eat, where when you take it in, it becomes absorbed into your system, Jesus is the bread of life who goes into you and rather than being absorbed, actually transforms you from within. And the transformation that happens is so that you can now live the life that he makes possible. Okay, we come to the Eucharistic table or the Lord's table or however you describe it so that Jesus can become a presence within us, a destabilizing presence within us so that the patterns of insecurity or fear or anxiety or ambition that we otherwise have in our hearts and minds when we engage the world, what we learn instead are the kinds of sympathies and affections and attention and considerate care that Jesus brings to his encounters with the world. It's a reorientation of our hearts and our minds. And I think it's instructive that the Gospel of John uses food as the way to communicate this. It's the intimacy of eating. It's the drawing in of Jesus into yourself. So that as Paul says, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Right? It's a fundamentally different orientation. And I don't at all want to suggest to you that this is easy. It's so much easier to live for yourself. It's so much easier to live with the world on your terms, on demand, than it is to live the kind of self-offering life that Jesus is calling people to live. But again, to recall a very important agrarian image in this gospel in John 12, Jesus says, except the grain of wheat fall into the ground and die, there cannot be much fruit. And his own life of self-offering becomes then the model for our own. The story of John 6, I don't think, is simply pious. It's revolutionary. Because what it's doing is it's calling us to a new conception of life altogether. John is convinced that you can exist and be dead because you don't know what life is for. You have to know that life is for the fullness, the abundance, the resurrection possibilities that are made possible through the life of Jesus. Learning to take care of each other becomes the means whereby the glory of God is achieved. So as a revolutionary insight, I think what John's gospel makes possible in us is ways to imagine new kinds of economic life together. We saw by looking at the Garden of Eden story how one of our most fundamental tasks is to learn to take care of the garden. Learn to see what are the needs of plants, fellow creatures. John, I think, gives us more insight by showing how Jesus also becomes the one who dwells among us so we can learn to dwell with each other. We need to learn to take care of each other so that we can again be a source of delight, right? I don't want to forget that when we look at our world, there's not a lot that we can delight in because so much is degraded. But this is where attending to this pain and suffering and degradation becomes the opportunity for us to contribute, not to ensure, but certainly to contribute to its healing. We cannot love others if we're happy to see them living in a poisoned, degraded world. And so I want to suggest, practically speaking, as we move forward, that faith communities become involved in the food and farming business. God's in the food and farming business. And my suggestion is that if faith communities become involved in this sort of work, the point is not that they will make every pain and hunger go away. Right? That's not going to happen. But the work of gardening together will become that activity. And I stress how important it is that this be a physical, embodied, practical, regular activity of joining us to the people we claim to serve, that we want to help. And this kind of intimacy of work together should not be underestimated. And along with working together, eating together. I grew up in a small farming community in southern Alberta. We didn't have much liturgy. We didn't have much music. Preaching was tolerable. But the one thing we did very well was we ate together a lot. And I can tell you that it's the meals I remember. I don't remember a single sermon. And I remember the meals because I remember how at those meals, people eating together, the work of ministry could happen. Because in eating together, someone would learn that Fritz Zimmerman is sick and it's harvest time and he needs help. And so people could say, I can be that help. And you may not have a Fritz Zimmerman in your congregation, but you may have somebody who's ill. Or you may have somebody who has a particular need that you have the skill that can respond to. And so the life of each other becomes not simply a bunch of spectators coming to see a good show once a week called worship. The life of the church becomes this economic joining together of people who have skill matching need. And the reality is that for any of us to even be willing to share the needs that we have requires trust. And eating together becomes the occasion in which we can live more deeply into the life of each other so that we can be willing to share our needs and our gifts with each other. This is going to call forth, I think, a whole set of priorities in churches that maybe aren't familiar right now to many. Years ago, I remember when churches started to have youth ministers, a number of people said, "That's an extravagance. Why would we do that?" Well, I'm dreaming of the day when churches will say, "You don't have a garden manager?" Churches sit on a lot of property. There's no reason why ornamental, poison-laden grasses and bushes and trees couldn't be transformed into flower gardens, vegetable beds, orchards that will be for the feeding and the healing of the world. These things are possible. When I first moved to North Carolina, there were just a very small number of church-supported gardens. Now I can't keep track of them. It's one of the most exciting things I'm seeing. And I talk to the people who are involved in these projects, and they say it's revitalizing their congregations. And this is not to romanticize, because it's hard. A number of them fail. Because gardening is hard work. And so to cultivate people who can cultivate land becomes a really important responsibility. I think within Christian life and practices, there have been this temptation to have a kind of otherworldly piety. And the height of spiritual attainment would be to be released from the care of bodies and the world. I think that's a huge mistake. Because the story of the Bible is a story of God who only, always, from the beginning until the end, has desired to be with us. Beginning with a God with knees in the soil, hands in the dirt. To the very end, when in Revelation, God descends from heaven to earth, because, as John says there, the home of God is among mortals. And so all those Christians who are thinking that the goal of life is to escape away, to go to heaven, they're going up and God is coming down. And they will be so disappointed. Thank you.
Have a good bit of time after our break, and for and these comments of Ellen and Wendell to have conversation.
Great, thank you. Well, if any of you came just kind of hoping to hear Wendell Berry today and were surprised by what you just heard, Merry Christmas. This is the second time we've brought Norman to Nashville to share on this topic, and every time it just takes me deeper and gives me that extra encouragement to get back out there in the backyard. So thank you for coming. I'm aware that I'm the last person standing between you and the break, so I'll make this brief. I am the president of Siloam Family Health Center, and we've been coordinating this whole weekend with Wendell and friends, and it's been a real pleasure. We're just delighted. Last night had a great event at MBA. Excited to see what unfolds from this morning. I just want to explain that we're not Shalom Family Health Center, although that's a common misunderstanding, although we don't mind being confused with the biblical concept of Shalom. But the word Siloam comes from John chapter 9. It's S-I-L-O-A-M. It's a pool in Jerusalem. And it was the place where, if you remember the story, Jesus was walking down the road and his disciples asked him, "Who sinned?" They saw a man born blind. Who sinned? Him or his parents, that this happened to him? And, you know, it's a lot like medical students, you know, always looking for causality, maybe blame. You know, often this discussion around food devolves into that, you know, anger, pointing fingers, what's wrong. And Jesus steps into that with this wonderful turn of phrase and says, "Well, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life." And that's really been the heart of Siloam Family Health Center for 22 plus years, is to look and see what God's doing in the life of the broken and the poor and the uninsured in this city, many of whom now are not from this city, but they're coming from over 70 countries around the world, and to see what God is doing to partner with him in that work of wholeness and healing. So you may ask, why would we be involved in a weekend like this? Well, as a health center for the poor, we're very aware that so many of the pathologies, the diseases, the infirmities of our patients are really the byproduct of bigger social and cultural pathologies around us. As a Christian health center, we're also aware that the answers, the path forward for engaging and finding healing is found in this story that Norman described, this picture of a garden moving towards a garden city that God created out of his delight and enters into in suffering and redemptive sacrifice. The Siloam Institute exists in part to train, maybe deprogram, healthcare professional students who are going into a hyper-specialized world that misses out on the wonder that's present in these encounters with the sick and the poor. But it also exists in part to give back to the Nashville community some resources, maybe share a little of the treasure that we're seeing and enjoying on a daily basis there. As you go to your break, there'll be a small table out to the side that has some more information where you can learn more about Siloam. One of the tools, there are many resources. Norman mentioned a few books. There'll be some for sale, I think, in the bookstore here today. One of the resources we'll be using this summer, we have some young pre-medical students who are about to enter their medical training who are coming to do a community health immersion experience. We'll embed them in a refugee apartment complex for 7 weeks, give them a food stamp equivalent budget, and tell them to fix their own meals for that time and see how it goes and how they can eat healthy and in a way that draws them closer into the realities that a lot of our patients face. One of the tools we'll give them as well is a very short and brand new documentary series put out by Regent College in Vancouver called Food for Thought. It's 4 30-minute segments, sort of an interactive glimpse into a class which sounds very much like the one Norman teaches at Duke on the theology of eating in some very practical ways and a very stimulating, and it could be used in a Sunday school format, could be used in a number of areas. We may even open up a class to the community later this year. If you're interested in that, it'll be playing on a loop out there and some information, and you can get on our mailing list for the Institute. There's no charge for today's event. It's really a pleasure to sort of contribute this back to the community, but we're thankful to St. George's for hosting it and for Christ Church Cathedral for co-sponsoring it. If you are in a giving mood and you want to contribute, if that generosity is there, there's no forum for that today. But it just so happens that Tuesday is a day called the Big Payback, and it's an online community-wide giving initiative hosted by the Community Foundation of Tennessee, of Nashville. And if you go to the website of the nonprofit that you're interested in, whether it's Siloam or any others of the many excellent nonprofits, you should have an opportunity to give that day in a way that there'll be incentives for prizes for nonprofits that raise certain amounts of money. But it's just a one day for the city to recognize and give back to the nonprofits that are doing so much good work around here. So with that in mind, I'm going to adjourn and let everybody go have a break.
Wendell said, how'd you comment on that one? You said he did fine.
I said it was faultless.
Yeah, faultless. Wendell said that Norman's talk was faultless. So, you know, I mean, that's pretty good, Norman. So we are delighted to have the folks that we have. I've already done the general introductions earlier. Our next commentator speaker is a delight. She's a phenomenal professor at Duke, as well as a great, literally nationally known preacher at the same time. And so, as I mentioned before, she'll be preaching tomorrow at Christ Church Cathedral for the morning services. We're delighted to have Professor Ellen Davis to make some comments in response to Norman and then participate in a roundtable with us.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much, Keith, and all of you who are hosting us here. It's an enormous pleasure to be here. I'm going to make 4 thoughtless remarks on the biblical text, 3 of which Norman Wurzba has treated, and then 1 of which I think, in a sense, he's pointing to obliquely, didn't treat directly. This is what we used to call footnotes. Now we call them sidebars. So I'm going to give you 4 biblical sidebars. Am I audible? Okay, good. Thank you. First, on Genesis 1 that Norman treated so beautifully, and I would just say that what seems to me most important in this passage is for us in terms of finding our place in the created order is the notion that we are created, B'Tselem Elohim, in the image of God, repeated three times. But when you think about it, that begins in verse 26 of chapter 1. When you think about it, we are created in the image of God. We're not told specifically that, you know, in other words, it means X. And the only thing we know about God at that point is that God is an appreciator of what God is calling into being. So I think that in that particular context, seeing ourselves in the image of God alludes to our participation in God's appreciation of the goodness of this world. It's an opportunity or an invitation to take part in God's, to use some of Norman's words, patient and careful seeing, careful in both senses of those of that word. As you know, the blessing of the human beings, God created them in the image of God, male and female, he created them in the image of God, he created them. It's repeated three times. And then he says, exercise, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and conquer it is the word. If you want to know why such an offensive word is used, you simply have to read my book. But then God says, we tend to render it exercise dominion over the creatures. I translate that exercise skilled mastery among the creatures. The Hebrew preposition is not actually over. But the problem with using the word dominion is we confuse it with domination. And I think that leads to poor interpretation in our present context. The main thing I want to say about Genesis 1 is I think it is a calling into God's appreciation of the world. That's foundational. From that position, we are then enabled to exercise a skilled mastery amongst the creatures. So it is a calling to responsibility, and that brings me to Genesis 2. Genesis 2:15, the Lord God formed the human being, Adam min ha'adama, Adam, humanity, from Adama, humus. It's a pun that works in Hebrew and also in English. Adam, humanity, comes from Adama, humus. And I will just say that this is really where we see what it means for humans to exercise skilled mastery amongst the creatures. It's where we see first what that looks like. I think Genesis 1 and Genesis 2 come from different sources, you know, different writing, oral and written traditions, but they're put together in something more than a hack editing job. And so Genesis 2 helps us reflect upon Genesis 1, and the Lord God set the human being in the garden to serve it and to preserve it. You could also translate that to work it and to watch it. To work it and to observe it. I think of our friend Wes Jackson speaking of nature as mentor and model. This is really Genesis 2:15 is saying exactly that. The human is set in the Garden of Eden to watch what it is doing and then therefore know how to do our own work. So, appreciation, responsibility. John 6, it seems to me, that's what I see in Genesis 1 and 2, appreciation, responsibility. John 6, I think, is a somewhat complementary and somewhat different view, and I think I have a somewhat different view of John 6 than Norman's. That doesn't mean that his is wrong and mine is right. The rabbis say, Hafochba, hafochba, hakolba of scripture. You keep turning it and turning it around because everything is in it. It's interesting in John 6 Jesus is the one who does the work of provision of food. This is not a time when it's important that he doesn't say to the disciples, you feed them. We get that in other Gospels. We don't get that in John. Jesus is the one who distributes the food. The people are fed. They are satisfied. And did you notice, you picked this up, Norman, this all happens in a grassy area. Okay? Why is that important to mention that it happens in a grassy area? Because if you know how John reads Scripture, he's reminding us, you know, it's his footnote. He's saying, think Psalm 23. He makes me lie down in grassy pastures. Okay? These are the footnotes of the biblical world. They didn't have footnotes. They used a phrase that's supposed to resonate in your mind so you know where we are located within the larger biblical story. We are the sheep. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand, as the psalmist says elsewhere. So the people, those 5,000, are fed, satisfied as the sheep of God in a grassy space. As we see them ourselves as in the sheep role in this feeding scene, it's a message of a grateful dependency and of satisfaction. They ate, they were satisfied, and then the disciples who did not feed them pick up what was left, presumably then to feed others. Very shortly thereafter, in the 35th verse of chapter 6, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall never go hungry. Whoever believes in me shall not thirst. So Jesus here represents God as provider. That moves me to one more text, this one that Norman did not mention specifically, but certainly had in mind when he said that there are many images in the Bible of God as farmer. I can think of two, two, possibly three, but the most overt one of them is Psalm 65. I want to mention Psalm 65 also in relation to your comment, Norman, that you were citing one of our students saying that we ought to begin saying grace with a prayer of confession. Okay? We should begin saying grace with a prayer of confession. Psalm 65 is actually a model of that kind of prayer. Psalm 65 begins with a confession of sin to God, saying our transgressions are greater than we are. So it begins with a confession of sin and then moves, without explaining that transition, moves to a picture of God, a picture of God as creator of the earth, and then a picture of God as a farmer working the soil of the earth. So we see the sort of the macrocosm, God creating the whole planet, as we would say, and then the microcosmic view of God as the farmer working in the hill country, forming the mounds. This is very steep country, difficult to farm, not unlike your home country, Wendell. So you have to make furrows. You have to make sure the soil will hold, water it carefully, semi-arid land. So we have this very particularizing picture of God as a farmer. What is the connection between the confession of sin and these two successive pictures of God, creator of the earth and then the tender of the earth? I think it's that in order to know our sins accurately, we have to see God accurately. If you don't know who God is, then you will not know how you are out of sync with all that God has made and is doing. Which is to say that knowing our sins depends on seeing God as the prayer of Thanksgiving and morning prayer in my tradition goes, seeing God as the, we thank you for all the, for creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. So seeing God as creator and sustainer and blesser of the good things that God has made. I'm going to end this by just reading you the last few lines of Psalm 65, because they are a sort of portrait of blessing in action. It's speaking to God, and God is saturating the furrows of the earth. You are setting its ridges, talking about how you farm in the steep hill country of Israel. You set its ridges. You moisten them with the light showers. You bless their growth. You have crowned the year with your goodness, and your wagon tracks are dripping ripeness. Just get that image. Speaking to God here, your wagon tracks are dripping ripeness. God is being envisioned here as a farmer coming home from the fields at harvest time with the grain overflowing from the wagon, the divine wagon. Your wagon tracks drip ripeness. The pastures of the wilderness are dripping. The hills are girdled, they're robed with joy. The meadows are wearing the flocks. They're clothed in the flocks. And the valleys are veiled with grain. They shout out, they even sing. So you have this picture of, it's sort of like Fantasia, okay? You have this picture of a whole animate world as God is driving home, as any farmer in ancient Israel, which was 95%, 98% of the population, would recognize this picture. What it is in a blessed year to be driving home through your fields with the grain falling out of the wagon, there is so much of it, and looking around at the grain still in the fields, the fields clothed with their flocks, wrapped in grain, and to hear all of this shouting out, singing to God for joy. I'm just going to end by saying that a line of the psalm, which is almost never properly translated, is the very first line of it, which reads, "To you, O God, silence is praise." To you, O God, silence is praise. And that's in the midst still of the part of the psalm that is confession. So it begins with silence, confession that we are out of sync with the world that God has made. And then it ends listening to the non-human creatures of God, the grain in the fields, the flocks of sheep and goats, shouting out, they even sing. Thank you.
I always learn so much from Ellen Davis. Thank you, Ellen. That was just... Wendell, you're on. You want to sit or stand?
No. Well, why don't we do the rest of this sit?
You want to sit?
Well,
all right.
What I want to have a discussion...
Anyway, Ellen's so secure on her ground and so fearful.
And I'm fundamentally insecure?
I haven't got to you yet.
All right.
I never have made a faultless speech in my life, but you stood up there and made a long speech and it was faultless.
Oh my.
I don't have any argument with it. I wanted to add something. And that is, I don't think you dealt with it because it would have been another speech. But in all this being fruitful and multiplying and living with the other creatures, there's an implicit cruelty. It sounds a little funny for a modern American with our arsenal of nuclear weapons and all our starving children and so on to be acknowledging a cruelty fundamental to our existence, but it is there. Nothing lives except at the expense of other creatures. The creatures of God, instructed to be fruitful and multiply, do so by eating and being eaten. And by eating, we fundamentally change the world. If a squirrel eats an acorn, there's an oak tree that's never going to grow. That's a fundamental change made. And this is happening all the time. This is the continuing creation, I suppose. So, when Norman talks about a deer problem with his garden, the thing I think of, because I'm disposed to think of it, is we need more hunters. One of the Aldo Leopold sagas was his attempt to control the deer population in Wisconsin with a doe season. Deer hunters were powerfully against it. They didn't see it. They wanted more deer to kill. Leopold knew they were destroying the forest. There's a fundamental conflict between deer overpopulation and forest, the health of the forest ecosystem. If you don't take care of the forest ecosystem, you lose deer anyway, ultimately. So if we're not going to have the large predators, we're going to have more deer hunters. We're going to have to eat more venison. I'm sorry, folks, vegetarians. Vegetarianism is not going to get you out of this dilemma. If you're a vegetarian, you're still eating things and being a thing that takes up room that would be occupied by other creatures if you weren't here. I don't object to vegetarianism, but I do object to political vegetarianism. There's no easy out. So I wasn't surprised when I discovered that the best witness that I've found for what's going on in the countryside, now that nearly everybody's gone, the countryside nearly deserted now. The young people are not in it playing. The older people are not in it working. The best witness I've found is a trapper. He knows what's going on. He's a hunter, he's a trapper, he's an ex-game warden. He's worked for the Fish and Wildlife people. He knows enough ecology to know that you shouldn't overhunt, overtrap, overfish. But he's connected to the landscape by bonds of economy and pleasure, the way nearly everybody used to be. The absence of country pleasures is as significant as the absence of real country work now. So that seems to me to be a good dose of complexity in our relationship to the natural world. Now, because of an article I wrote recently, I received a number of letters from the Holy Right. One advising me that contraception is nearly as bad as, or is as bad as pornography. So I wrote back, population control is an ecological necessity. It's a reality. If you're going to come out against contraception, or birth control, or whatever you want to call it, then you've got to come out for famine, plague, war, and the other things that have controlled the human population. By golly, you've got to control it.
Amen.
Have you told the Pope?
I would. He hasn't asked me. Well, we've been talking. Norman and I were talking last night about the ecological framework in which our economy has taken place, largely without acknowledging that framework. And part of acknowledging the framework is taking responsibility for population control of various kinds. I mean, a healthy community would spawn enough coon hunters to keep the coons under control, for instance. Well, y'all can...
Well, I think that's really important. I think what your question is bringing up is our inability to talk about death with much intelligence. And you talk about how a health system that doesn't talk about death is ridiculous. And I agree with you. And one of the things I was thinking about as you were talking about the deer issue, one of my good friends is a forest ecologist at Duke, and he's been watching the Duke forest for a number of years, and he said, just as you have observed, that the deer are destroying the forest. And the forest is being destroyed by these deer because about 30 years ago, well-meaning citizens in Durham and Chapel Hill said, we have to stop killing deer because it's cruel. And they're just running the whole forest to the ground by consuming it. And
so starving deer is less
right.
cruel
and this,
than shooting them.
Every day I drive into work, there's roadkill from dead deer because That's there right. are just so many. And we don't understand how we're to articulate what the issue of death is in our society. And that's a big
This
question.
Doesn't mean that we don't acknowledge the sanctity of these creatures. Mm-hmm. It just means that we have to know how to respect them mm-hmm. and to do the required, what do you call it, the compensations, the right apologies to creation for living from it as directly and cruelly as we have to.
Can I just make one observation? I've been reading around a fair amount with indigenous cultures and First Nations peoples, and this one account that I was reading, which was fantastic, is about an Inuit culture, and it was describing how, as Inuit, you live by hunting whale and seal, and sometimes these hunters would go out in their small little canoes out to hunt whale, and one of the elders was being interviewed, and he said, well, isn't it preposterous that you would go out to hunt a big whale with these small little rafts? I mean, the whales could just easily destroy you. And he said, well, absolutely. But in our culture, for a hunter to go out to hunt whale presupposed that the hunter was morally pure, because the whale would only offer themselves to a hunter that was pure. Because, and he said, it's very important to understand, we believe that the whales are never taken. They are only ever offered to us if we are worthy of receiving them. So there's a kind of moral formation that has to happen in the person who's going to kill a whale. It's just fascinating. And they said, one hunter in the village was so unsuccessful because his home was so disordered. And so the whales knew that, and so they would never offer themselves to him. Is this fascinating?
So there's propitiation is the word I was looking for. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure I have a functional mic. Is
Ellen, can you hear Ellen?
You can hear me? Oh, good, okay. I would just say that within biblical tradition, probably the most important book for this perception of how our practices fit into a larger ordering of the world is one Christians almost never read. It's Leviticus. And because Leviticus is entirely a creation-oriented picture of the world, Wendell, you were speaking last night about... You were speaking about acting as if we loved people. And actually, the verse from Leviticus chapter 19 that we translate, love your neighbor as yourself, is, I forget the word that you were using, but you were saying hypocrisy. Pretend you love them even if you don't. Well, actually, the Hebrew phrase has act lovingly toward your neighbor as yourself, which doesn't, you know, it's not an emotional statement. It's about how right. your action is to be demonstrated. And, but Christians tend to say, well, we don't follow the moral law in Leviticus. We don't follow the ceremonial law in Leviticus. We follow the moral law, which is why we think that one verse plus two others about homosexuality are important for us, and the others are not important for us because they're ceremonial law. But they're all mixed up in Leviticus. I mean, the very next thing following love your neighbor as yourself is, and don't sow two different kinds of seed in your field, don't mix two different kinds of animals, and don't wear two different kinds of cloth. It's all about, it's a symbolic system for maintaining, observing, and honoring the orders of creation, is basically what Leviticus is saying. But the main point is that Leviticus says almost, you know, it touches on sexuality, it focuses on what you eat. Mm-hmm. But, and Jews know that. This is why Jewish children, six-year-old Jewish children, begin studying Torah with Leviticus. Christians never touch it. And we wonder why we have a problem.
Did you write, or did you use the phrase in speaking to me, you referred once to that green book Leviticus?
Yeah. I think
you
I've,
did that.
I think it's shown up in stuff.
Well, now, would they not have sowed legumes with their grass?
It's interesting. I mean, this is kind of a, you know, we're kind of guessing. I think the Bible represents different perspectives. I don't think Leviticus ever represented the dominant perspective in ancient Israel, because it says, the clearest evidence to me is that it says you don't let your animals breed across kinds. Well, we know Israelites use mules a lot. Mm-hmm. But in a particular symbol system, no, I think they would not have. But we also know that mixed farming is almost certainly how they made that very limited amount of land sustain the population. So I think it's, you know, a particular group would have seen that as probably not the right thing to do, but it's a symbolic ordering of the universe.
Well, now let me ask you this. There is a fairly honorable permission or instruction to learn both by scripture and by creature. Mm-hmm. So if you receive further instructions from the creation, does that permit a revision of scripture?
Well, I would say in this.
Boy, those questions.
No, it's a really crucial question. I think my general answer is that the way I see scripture is showing us the sort of dimensions of the argument. And so, as I say, I don't think Leviticus was ever popular theology in Israel. I think it represents a particular symbol system that emphasizes keeping the different elements of creation distinct from each other. And I don't think it's how most people did. So that's one part of an answer. But when people say, I take my stand by scripture, they think that answers the question. It's sort of like saying, it's similar to what you object to in political vegetarianism. Thinking that you can come up with a single, simple answer that ends the struggle. And that's simply not how interpretation of scripture works.
Can I just follow up on that a little bit?
Did you need to adjust the mic?
I was going
to
see if there's
anything. It isn't.
So I want to follow
see, the
up
Lord
on
doesn't
this.
Want this to go on in this
way. We aren't that simplistic, okay?
So I want to follow up on that question. I think it's a really, really important one. And we mentioned a little bit about this in the car. We think that when
profound.
which one was that?
Something just exploded.
Well, I'm suddenly having the best time.
Wherever you go, Wendell, it happens. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
It does. We were about to get something, weren't we?
We were.
All right, let's go
looking
ahead.
For the pen. Yeah. So I was thinking that, you know, yesterday we were talking about how the idea of the fact, the idea of that kind of reality is a rather new one. I think sometimes when we think about the world, we think it's a world of facts. And that's a profound mistake because the world itself is an interpreted reality. So, for instance, when I was talking about how you name a plant, right, there are multiple ways that we name the experiences of our encounters with non-human creatures. And so I like to think that the question about the book of nature versus the book of scripture is one that's in a kind of conversation with each other, in which our experiences with the world inform and sometimes challenge and deepen what we understand. We think scripture is teaching us, just as the way we read scriptures can inform the way we're looking at the world around us. And so I don't know that there's ever a kind of simple scriptural view, as Ellen just said, or a simple natural view, which is out there. There are always interpretive matrices that are going on that are in a kind of conversation. And the key is to have the conversation honest enough so that we can see when we're fooling ourselves about what we're reading in the Bible and what we're seeing in the world. Mm-hmm. Because it's very easy, I think, to fool ourselves.
Because we see what we want to see.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you mic'd up now, Ellen?
Who knows?
Yeah, you are.
Yeah.
Oh, right. You're with us. Great.
Okay. All right.
Other comments among our three panelists? Are three of you guys any responses, Norman?
Well, yeah, Wendell's question about death is the, I think, the really difficult one for me, and contemplate a world in which every creature must eat, which means every creature to live must deal with the death, it precipitate the death. And so the question of death is one that's a very important one and a very, very difficult one, because I don't think that we have a very good understanding of death. I think when we say that death is simply the cessation of biological function, that's a really impoverished view of what death is, and that death functions in different sorts of ways in Scripture. And maybe, you know, Ellen can say some things about this, but how do we live faithfully and compassionately in a world in which we know that for us to live, others have to die? I don't know how to answer that other than to say that from what I understand about reading Scripture, that to receive the gift of another's life and death presupposes that we learn to give our lives to the creatures that we live among. And that is perhaps the only kind of faithful response that we can make. It's not a response that comes out of some deep comprehension, because we really fundamentally, I don't think, know what we're doing when we're doing that. But it is the best gesture that we can try to make when we understand how our living presupposes the gift of another's death. That we have to somehow learn to make our lives a gift to others.
I don't think that it's possible to come to a conclusion on this subject.
Right.
The relationship between a good shepherd and a flock of sheep is intimate. And it can be very moving. I'm a shepherd in a small way. Milton says the sheep look up to be fed. In Lycidas. And they look up because they're dependent on the shepherd. Shepherd's dependent on the sheep. And this conversation between the shepherd and the sheep is an extraordinary thing. Sheep are very vocal mothers, new mothers. And when the lamb is born, they're extraordinarily moved and grateful. This thing that wasn't all of a sudden is, and they can't say enough about it. You ought to listen to them. And they're saying the same thing that human mothers say. It's not, you know, nonsense. You're the sweetest thing that ever your mama ever saw. It's the same thing, same meaning. The mother doesn't mean anything. It has any current significance for anybody else. But you sit there and you listen to that. I was sitting last year, happened to be at the barn when you started to lamb, and I just sat down, just sort of to be with her, you know. You would get a contraction, get like that, and I would sit there and I'm but I thought, you fool, stop that. You're not having the lamb. I'd sit there directly, she'd get another one, I'd go, Well, this is sympathy, you see. And as I was saying last night, there's money in it. But this intimate, lovely relationship exists because we're going to eat the sheep. This requires a lot of feeling and thought and stuff, and I don't think there's any way to resolve it. Well, I did improve on St. Paul, or I let one of my characters improve on St. Paul. You know, St. Paul said we're members one of another. He was talking about the Christians. And I made a story in which Burley Coulter says we're members of each other, all of us, everything. The difference ain't in who is and who's not, but in who knows it and who don't. See, that's after ecology. I don't think you can resolve that. Mm-hmm. What do you do if you're members of each other? Well, some of them you're going to eat. Some of them you're going to be eaten by, ultimately. Mm-hmm. Gary Snyder has a poem which he says, to be eaten. Which is his approving submission. Mm-hmm. To eat, to be eaten, to be in the process, to be grateful for.
Nature is a conjugation of the verb to eat. It's what the Cambridge Dean Ralph Inge said once.
Well, all right.
let me just stir a little bit with one of the questions from our audience. This person said, I work with a faith-based conservation group that began overseas. We've experienced resistance in the United States as we try to create change through churches and faith-based groups, largely because of politics. The resistance is not as prevalent overseas. Underline, how do American Christians overcome political barriers to reach these faith groups? Can you give me positive examples of encouragement? The political context in America and how it challenges the efforts you're talking about today, Norman.
Well, oh my. Positive examples. I don't know if I'll get to there.
You didn't talk about the problem first.
Well, I mean, there are issues about regulation, for instance. I mean, there's this thing called the Food Safety and Modernization Act that was being promoted in Congress, which basically would have done in any small-scale natural systems organic farmer. And it's an act that with its title sounds just wonderful, right? Who's going to be opposed to food safety? But what it was is an attempt to make sure that small-scale producers can't be in business. And so there's no question that within the political climate and the economic climate that we have in our food system today, there's this desire to consolidate the food sector into smaller and smaller hands that are going to be bigger and bigger in their reach. And so I think one of the really crucial things is for people who eat food to be aware of these kinds of things, right? So that when you hear something like the farm bill, you're not thinking that that's for farmers, that the farm bill is a food bill, which means it's a citizen bill. And therefore people need to understand how in the writing of a farm bill, all sorts of food policy are going to be decided that have direct impact on whether or not you're going to have access to food that is produced by small-scale producers who don't have, you know, $100,000 to spend on identification and regulation and building of new facilities for cleanliness and toilets and all other sorts of things that this act would have imposed. And so, I mean, I think a lot of the problem is that this is a bill that gets written by a small number of people, and for the most part, the eaters in this country think it doesn't affect them, and of course it does. So simply becoming aware of the kinds of food policies that are being written would be a step to helping. But when, I mean, you've worked with this.
Who wrote that question? Can you describe a little more of the political barriers that are distressing you? Because I think it's thoughtful what the work you've done.
Could you ask her to come up forward?
Sure, sure. Can you come up forward? Just come up here so they can hear you.
I would say that there's a large faith community that maybe ignores or decides that some of the science isn't true or real about what's happening to our land and food and earth. And so how do Christians, without saying, oh, you're those Christians over there who think that, and we're the right Christians who think this, how can we engage together and kind of encourage them as we encourage ourselves to be more mindful? I guess that would be another question.
Does that help?
Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's clarifying. I think one thing to do is to get these Christians together and read Alan's book. Because I think one thing that a lot of the Christians who speak this sort of way is to discount the importance of land issues and food issues is they're not reading the Bible. And it's everywhere in the Bible. And, you know, Alan talks about this wholesome materiality that you find in Scripture. And so for Christians who maybe don't agree about these things because they're so politically laden, to say, let's read Scripture together and see what it says about food and land and fruitfulness and sharing and reconciliation and healing and all those sorts of things, it's really eye-opening. And, you know, you can get really discouraged when you realize that a lot of Christians are getting their marching orders from Rush Limbaugh or talk radio or whatever. They're not even reading their Bibles. But I think if you get Christians and say, you think we should read the Bible, you think that's important, they'll probably say yes, and then do it and see what happens.
Well, the liberals are just as big a threat as Rush Limbaugh.
Mm-hmm. Say that again.
One more time, more loudly.
Well, I revert to my belief that the effort to change other people is just awful. I think we've all got to face Nathan. Thou art the man. You're the one who needs to be changed. My authority on this is Will Campbell. Will Campbell was a very humorous man. He knew that the funniest thing in the world was to measure Christianity by the Gospels. It's just rich in comedy. And Will Campbell's message to Christians was, don't think that you've become a Christian by being politically right. Don't think you're a Christian just because you're a liberal on civil rights. Don't think you're a Christian because you believe in the effort of black people to get civil rights. You still got to deal with the Ku Klux Klan members. You've got to know them. You've got to extend your love to them. Well, what he's saying is that the gospel is a lot more radical than politics, than politics is ever going to be. That's where Christians or would-be Christians are stuck. Something a lot more radical than any political party is ever going to be.
Now, I would just add, I want to pick up on the comment of a questioner that in other parts of the world, you don't encounter the same resistance. And let me say two things. First of all, the Bible doesn't imagine that the kinds of things that political systems are concerned about are the kinds of things that religious communities or systems can afford to ignore. Everyone knows that those things, they're always, they're contesting for the same territory, which is the dimensions of human life. But North American Christians have this strange notion that those two spheres can be separated. We do so, of course, in very inconsistent ways, in very opportunistic ways. But the rest of the church globally is not with us on this, by any means. And I was quite struck in January. I was teaching in Kampala, in Uganda, and I was teaching a group of Christians from East African, the Great Lakes nations in East Africa. And the particular focus of our seminar was on land use and the Bible. And the final assignment at the end of this intensive workshop of about a week, I asked them all to design a workshop that they could and would actually give in their own context. And one person in our group designed a workshop he intended to give to members of parliament in Kenya. And it was on how the Bible should be used in forming land policies in Kenya. And I said, and you can actually do that to members of parliament? And he said, oh yeah, it'd have much more teeth if we actually said the Bible, you know, talks about this stuff. So I said, well, I should move to Kenya, I could rule the world. but, you know, to us it was just incoherent. To them it was incoherent that we could think, well, these are political issues, these are economic issues, and these are religious issues.
They're right.
Yeah.
And along some of those lines, in some ways I think relevant, the poignancy of one of our questions. My sister is a single mom with two children. She never went to college, often works long hours and multiple shifts at low-paying jobs, and she buys her groceries with food stamps. While the idea of getting back to a more intimate relationship with our food sounds great, it also sounds like a luxury that people like my sister cannot afford with time or money. What do you do for people like her? Can we reasonably hope to teach mindful eating or gardening when she's fresh off a double shift?
Well, I feel I need to say something because it's a great question, and it's one that comes up over and over again. And I think one way to start is to say that eating isn't something we do in alone. And I don't mean just the eating that happens at the table, but the whole context of eating, from the purchasing of food to the availability of food to the pricing of food, none of that's to be done alone. And so we have a situation in which there are a lot of people who are in a predicament just like this. And it's terrible. And I think we need to start by acknowledging that. I think also then the question becomes, if communities of people have eating as a concern, because eating, I would argue, is a communal, fundamentally, activity, then the community should be attentive to people like this, who will then say that you're in a situation which is not right, and we need to work with you so that you can experience eating as a form of delight, where there can be a kind of mindfulness of eating, and that they're not consigned to buying unhealthy food that we know will make them ill, will not be good for her children. And this is where faith communities, when they get practical, and they're not just talking piously about things, will be working with this woman, will be inviting her to participate in the growth of her own food, not because she needs more work to do, but because they're finding other ways then to take some of the pressure off of her so that she does have the space and the time in which she might be able to work in a community garden.
But isn't that taking membership more seriously than
Well, for
we
sure it is.
Time?
And it's and this is really hard to do. I'm no expert in any of this. Because I can be as individualistic and self-seeking as anybody. But this is the kind of work that I think we're called to do if we're a membership. So that, you know, I think we've gotten into this idea that the only way we're going to eat well is if we go to Whole Foods. And that's ridiculous. Because then it becomes this elite movement in which very poor people are excluded automatically. But if we understand that for generations, millennia, people have been involved in their own food production, then why isn't it possible that communities can be involved in food production so that those who do not have the resources or the time can still have access to good food? The option is not Whole Foods or food stamps. Another option is help people grow food together.
The question assumes that we think we know the answer to that problem. I don't think anybody up here does. We need to know more about the sister and the quality of the food that she gets, the time she has actually available, the health of her children and her health. Those things are consideration. The larger dilemma is that the United States cheap food policy has been a disaster. Cheap food kills the producer. That the cost ultimately is always paid by the producer. The farmer is the last person to be considered and the lowest person to be paid. You can just depend on that. It's been so forever. So the sister of the question is not the only victim of the system. So I would say that in general, I'm against cheap food. That leads me directly to the question, what are you going to do for people in the position of this sister, and more generally, people in slums and ghettos who don't have grocery stores, who are paying too much for their food anyway under the present system? And I know that the people who are trying to develop local food economies are very mindful of this predicament that the sister's in. So I think we have to leave it there. We don't know the answer. A lot more people are aware of the need for an answer than were even 10 years ago, certainly 20 years ago. 20 years ago, this conversation couldn't have taken place. Conversations are taking place on Manhattan Island now, and people are listening comprehendingly. It's pretty insignificant now in comparison to the whole land use scene, so to speak. The acreages that are involved in the local food economy effort and the good food effort and the slow food effort and all those efforts is tiny. Still, most of the land is being abused, and being abused worse than ever. So to be involved in this effort is to be confused and ignorant and sick at heart a lot of the time.
Profoundly clear and challenging.
I made that obscurity profoundly clear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
What role or roles does a divinity school play in these issues?
Oh, boy.
When I would answer that question differently now than I would have certainly 20 years ago. When I started, it's now more than 20 years ago that I started teaching classes related to this at a divinity school in the Northeast. And none of my students considered this to be a theological problem. And I always, when I'm teaching a seminar, I always begin by saying, so why are you teaching this class? Why are you taking this class? And it never had to do, the answers to that never had to do with the intrinsic importance of the subject. That has drastically changed. Also, the level of knowledge with which students arrive. When Duke Divinity School began to sort of support my interest in this, they would invite me to address the incoming students on this. And I remember one year coming in, and I would have to begin by saying our food system is broken and begin by giving a few statistics to people who had no idea there was a problem at all because they hadn't been hungry. Now maybe a dozen years, no, less than that, maybe 10 years ago, I came in one day to the introductory students and I said, I'm guessing you know that there's a problem in our food system, and what you need to hear from me is, what does the Bible have to do with that? And they said, yeah, we're all aware of the problem, just give us the Bible on it. That was progress. And that was from our larger culture. So it's actually an easier job, as I see it, for the Divinity School now, because we are not in the position of convincing some people that something is important and has theological import. We are giving them tools for thinking about it theologically, but they want those tools. They come asking for them. It's an easier job than it used to be.
Much more good.
Yeah,
does Mendel get any credit for that, for it being easier than it used to be?
I think it's a lot of things. I think your work is important, Wendell. Something I take as a really significant marker was the 2005 Millennium Ecosystem Assessment from the UN Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. And it was put out in the end of 2005, but it did not hit the Duke University Library until 2007. And it says that agriculture is possibly the greatest driver of ecosystem degradation, full stop. And that was one of the things that began opening up the conversation, because all of our students for a long time have been concerned about ecology, for instance. Well, linking that with agriculture in a university setting, if you're talking about a divinity school, you're talking about a university setting, that has changed the conversation. I remember shortly after that, 2000.